We're grateful that God has called and gathered us here this morning to hear his word and receive his sacrament.
Without the Holy Spirit of God, our resolutions to improve are impotent. Therefore, let us seek the forgiveness of our sins and the indwelling of the Spirit to lead us in the path of righteousness. Please kneel as you're able or be seated for the confession. Merciful Father,
if I look back, I see a record of sin and rebellion against your ways.
By your word, draw my eyes away from the past and toward your Son, my Lord Jesus Christ. The Almighty God is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. For the sake of the suffering and the death of his beloved Son, God freely grants you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thanks and praise to you, Lord. Please rise. May the God of peace be with you all. Let us share the peace with one another. With you. Let us remain standing for our opening hymn 90, Song of Thankfulness and Praise.
Thank you.
We pray together the prayer of the day. Eternal Father, Ancient of Days, as another year begins, help us to humbly and joyfully receive the Word made flesh, your beloved Son. Conform our lives more and more to His, that we may be true disciples and a blessing to the world. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
The first reading is from Psalm 111. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart in the company of the upright in the congregation. Great are the works of the Lord, studied by all who delight in them. Full of splendor and majesty is his work, and his righteousness endures forever. He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and merciful. He provides food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever. He has shown his people the power of his works in giving them the inheritance of the nations. The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy. They are established forever and ever to be performed with faithfulness and uprightness. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever. The word of the Lord. The second reading is from the fourth chapter of Galatians. When the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir through God. The word of the Lord.
I'd like to invite any children forward for our children's message. Good morning. Well, it's good to see you all this morning. Did you have fun last night for a New Year's Eve? Yeah, I think Joey had a little too much fun last night. You know what he's having trouble with? Remember that candy cane?
Yeah.
It's gone. Yep, he had a little too much fun. Well, I have a little story to tell you. One of the names that is given for God in the Bible is the Ancient of Days. Okay, so God never ages. He doesn't get older. He is always and eternal. That's one way to think about God is eternal. He never gets older. So one day there was this man named Israel. And Israel was praying to Yahweh. And he said, Yahweh, is it true that for you one day is like 1,000 years? And Yahweh said, yes, is he? That's it. That's true. And Israel said, is it true that $1 million for you is just a penny? And Yahweh said, yes, Izzy, that's true, that's true. And Israel said, Yahweh, could I have a penny? And Yahweh said, certainly, Izzy, I'll have it for you next year. Could be 1,000 years before he gets that, right? Well, God is not caught or trapped by time like we are. We're trapped in time, and we're going to get older, and someday we're going to die, and that makes a lot of people very sad. But what we're celebrating this this time of year is that Jesus came to us, a Savior, and he will take us out of the trap of time, and he will take us to be with him and with God the Father, and we won't ever get any older, and we won't suffer, and we won't die. So this is a tremendous promise and a tremendous gift that comes to us at Christmas time. And who knows, when we get to heaven, maybe Yahweh will give us a penny. Let's say a prayer this morning. Dear God, thank you for Jesus, the only gift we need. Give us faith in him until we see him in your kingdom. Amen. Amen. Thanks for coming up this morning. Oh, Joey left some of his small candy canes here. You can come get one. We stand for the hearing of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the second chapter. Glory to you, Lord. Now, when the Magi had departed from Bethlehem, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Rise, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt and remain there until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." And he rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, "Out of Egypt I called my son." Then Herod, when he saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, became furious, and he sent and killed all the male children in Bethlehem and in all that region who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had ascertained from the wise men. Then was fulfilled what was spoken by the prophet Jeremiah. A voice was heard in Ramah, weeping and loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be comforted because they are no more. But when Herod died, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt, saying, "Rise, take the child and his mother and go to the land of Israel, for those who sought the child's life are dead." And he rose and took the child and his mother and went to the land of Israel. But when he heard that Archelaus was reigning over Judea in place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go there. And being warned in a dream, he withdrew to the district of Galilee. And he went and lived in a city called Nazareth, so that what was spoken by the prophets might be fulfilled, that he would be called a Nazarene. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
You may be seated. Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace to you and peace from God the Father and our Lord Jesus. Amen. I probably told a few of you this story, or maybe you've heard it elsewhere, but I've heard it said that when you first meet somebody, there are three common questions you'll ask them. Now, these questions vary just a little bit, but for the most part, if you're from either coast or a large city, those questions are these. 1, what's your name? 2, where are you from? And 3, what do you do for a living? However, if you're from the middle of the country or a small town or rural area like most of us are, those three questions are these. 1, what is your name? 2, where are you from? And 3, oh, do you know the Johnsons or the Kriegers or the Smiths or, you know, you name it. But I mention this little story because there is something to the second question that is particularly pertinent for today's gospel. Where are you from? There is something deeper in that question than simply wanting to know someone's hometown. I think there is a desire to understand someone's origins, and understanding their origins to begin to get a grasp on what we might be able to expect from them. Interestingly, this question was asked about Jesus,
and even directly to Jesus a number of times. Herod certainly wanted to know where Jesus was from, so that he could eliminate him as a possible threat to the throne. The wise men wanted to know where the newborn king was from, so that they could ingratiate themselves to this new and powerful king. Think about it. If someone of great power is entering your world and is bound to have a significant impact on your life, you are going to want to get on their good side. And as he called his first disciples, Philip told Nathanael, "We have found Jesus, the Messiah, from Nazareth." Remember what Nathanael said? "Nazareth? Can anything good come from there?" And finally, as Jesus neared the end of his ministry, Pontius Pilate asked him that exact question: "Where are you from?" Well, where was Jesus from? You could answer Bethlehem, the place of his birth. You could answer Nazareth, the place he spent most of his childhood and early adult years. You could say Egypt, as the Gospel of Matthew quotes Hosea saying, "Out of Egypt I have called my son." He lived there for a while. And as he went about his ministry, he might have no answer at all to that question, "Where are you from?" When he said, "Foxes have holes, birds have nests, I don't have anywhere even to lay my head." But then as he sat at his Last Supper, teaching his disciples many things, he made it clear to them where he was from. In John 16:28, we hear him say, "I came from the Father, and I came into this world, and now I am leaving the world and going back to the Father." And of course, we remember from the beginning of John's Gospel, he was in the world, and the world was made through him, but the world did not know him. The world, which was crafted by the Father through the working of the Word, the world which God so loved, so as to send his only begotten Son into it, that world did not know him. And not knowing him, it did not want him. It wasn't only Herod who wanted to get rid of Jesus. It was, and it still is, the entire world caught in bondage to sin that wants to rid itself of Jesus, along with any and all who bear his name or who bear the mark of his cross, who have been grafted into him and who follow him, who have the lifeblood of the true vine coursing through their veins and producing the fruit of the kingdom. You know, even from his conception, Jesus was chased from place to place by the world that knew him not and wanted him not. Forced from Nazareth to go to Bethlehem, from Bethlehem forced to flee to Egypt from the murderous designs of a paranoid king, from Egypt back to Israel, but only in Israel for the shortest times, because again, out of fear of an earthly king. And then on to Nazareth. And there in Nazareth, we can assume he was able to lead a relatively normal childhood until his adult ministry was to begin. But even there, we have that strange episode when he was merely 12 years old, when he is left behind in Jerusalem as his family is returning to Nazareth. And we hear the answer his parents had to find very strange when they found him in the temple: "Didn't you know that I would be in my Father's house?" Throughout his ministry, he had to make numerous escapes, because the world simply was not going to let him have his way unimpeded. And at last, of course, the world breathed a sigh of relief as it watched him breathe his last from upon the cruelest instrument of torture and punishment the world could design: the cross. Only as you well know, and I'm glad you know this, the world had not in fact witnessed the last of him, but only the completion of his work, punctuated 3 days later by the exclamation point of the resurrection. Where is Jesus from? He's from the heart of the Father. And you, where are you from? You are not from Clintonville. You're not from Marion or Tigerton or Bear Creek or Shawano or even Wisconsin or America. Because you have been born not of the blood or the will of man or the will of the flesh. You have been born of God. Therefore, you are from the heart of God. And you are only here on a pilgrimage, a journey through a world that does not know you and doesn't particularly want you around and may do all it can to rid itself of you. But thanks be to God, you do not make this journey, this pilgrimage, alone. No, no, no. You see, you walk beside the one who created this world. You walk in his power. You walk in his compassion for this world, even though it does not know you or want you. Your journey, because it is grafted into him and his journey, is a force for redemption in this broken and sinful world. And he has already redeemed you. And your journey finally will bring you back to the place from which you came. Your journey ends in the heart of God, a home that right now you only have a faint vision of. A home that is absolutely radiant and resplendent with joy and with peace, where there is no night. A home that has no lack of any good thing. A home that doesn't know the word goodbye. A home that suffers no pain and sorrow, and a home where death does not and cannot exist. If the world finds you strange and asks, where are you from? You can tell the world, I'm from the heart of God. The heart that beats with love for you. And you're simply making your way back home. I'll see you there. Amen.
We stand and join in singing our sermon hymn, Alleluia, Song of Gladness.
Thank you.
Together with the saints of all times and places, we confess the one true faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God,
the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being of the Father, through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated. And let us join our hearts in prayer. Almighty and merciful God, we thank you for your guiding hand that has led us through the past year. We thank you for all the joys and blessings. We thank you, Lord, for keeping us in the midst of trial and struggle. And Lord, we pray that in the coming year, we would be filled with hope, healing, and peace. And with our eyes on your Son, knowing that by your Holy Spirit you will guide us through all things, whether good or bad. Bless us in 2017 and help your church to be your light to the world so that we would continue to focus on what you have called us to do, to go forth and make disciples of all nations. In the name of your Son, Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, we pray on behalf of those who at times in this world feel as if they do not belong. Help them to know, Lord, that they are of you, and that you have called them to be a part of this world, and that though they might not find peace and certainty here, that we are only but a stranger here, and that heaven is our home. Give them hope, give them peace, give them comfort. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, Prince of Peace, we ask that you would be upon the hand of all the military who serve abroad across many nations. Lord, we ask that you would bring peace to all conflict, be with our men and women as they serve bravely, and that, Lord, we pray for the chaplains who serve alongside them, that, Lord, that when they look in the midst of their danger, that they would have a preacher next to them reminding them that you are with them even in the midst of the hells of war. We ask, Lord, that you would bring all conflict to an end, and that, Lord, we would even pray for our enemies, that, Lord, that they would turn to you, they would hear your word of truth, and put down their weapons of hatred and division. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, we pray on behalf of those who mourn the loss of loved ones. We pray especially for the families of Dennis Bricko and Franklin Vandergate. Be with their families as they mourn the loss of their loved one. Give them the peace and certain hope of the resurrection, knowing that in our baptism, though we are baptized into a death like yours, that we too certainly shall be raised in a resurrection like yours. So help them, Lord, to turn over their grief and their sorrow to you, knowing that they and their loved ones are in the hands of a merciful Father. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray on behalf of all those who are sick and needing of your healing hand. We pray for those, Lord, who have procedures ahead in the next week, whether they be at a doctor's office, whether it be at a dentist's office or any other procedure that may be going on in the next week, that, Lord, we ask that your healing hand would be upon them. And we pray for all the doctors and nurses and physicians who will care for these people, that, Lord, that their skills would be at peak performance and that they would do a good work on those who they are caring for. And, Lord, we pray for those who go through the downs of life of depression and mental illness. Lord God, bless them, give them peace in their hearts and mind. And be with those who have afflictions of the body, whether it be cancer, whether it be vertigo, whether it be any other thing. Help them to know, Lord, that they're in the hands of a Savior, and that though their body may go through the pains of life today, that we have the certain hope of healing tomorrow. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for all the missionaries who serve here in the United States as well as abroad throughout the world. Bless them in their missions. Help them, Lord, to have bravery. We pray for those who cling to your word, and we pray that they would preach good doctrine. We thank you for the missions that do good work of helping all pastors to keep the doctrine clear and true, like the Augustana District. Bless them and all the LCMC and their ministries, and be with all churches, so that we may be a group that points people to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We bring forth our tithes and our offerings. We pray together now our offertory prayer. Heavenly Father, you richly supply what we need for life and abundance besides. Receive these offerings in your mercy and use them in us to the benefit of your children. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink of this, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
You may be seated. If you hunger and thirst for righteousness, for peace, for salvation, come and receive.
Are breaking, how we need to hear from God. You've been promised, we've been waiting. Welcome, Holy Child. Welcome, Holy Child. Hope that you don't mind our manger. How I wish we would have known. Long awaited, holy stranger, make yourself at home. Make yourself at home. So wrap our injured flesh around you, breathe our air and walk our sod. Rob our sin and make us holy, perfect Son of God, perfect Son. Thank you.
Please rise. Now may the body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood strengthen you in body and soul and keep you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen.
Some announcements before we go. The 2017 envelopes for offering are available for pickup outside the church office. So if you'd like to pick those up today, they are available for you. The Greenwood Cemetery, which is managed by Christus Lutheran Church, is looking for one or two more additional members for its committee, so for its board. So if you would like to be a part of that committee, please let church office or Christy Hansen know if you're interested. Our thoughts and prayers are with a family of Franklin Vandergate, who passed away on the 30th of December. His funeral will be on Tuesday at 11 a.m. with a visitation starting at 10, but then also the night before on Monday evening, I believe starting at 6 at Bile Didier Funeral Home. And so our thoughts and prayers are with Bev and Franklin's family who are mourning his loss. But then also we are mourning with the family of Dennis Bricko, who passed away yesterday, and I believe funeral arrangements are still
pending.
So we'll keep you posted, and you can check the, I believe, Eberhard Stevenson website and those things for updates. Receive now the benediction. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us now go to our ascending hymn, Go, My Children, with My Blessing.
Thank you.
In Christ, the old is gone, the new has come.